researcher and board-certified general internist and palliative medicine physician. He is also the director of the Center for Outcomes Research and Evaluation at Maine Medical Center. He received an MD at New York University School of Medicine, an MA in bioethics, an MPH at the University of Pittsburgh, and completed internal medicine residency training at UCLA, and a fellowship in cancer prevention and control at the National Cancer Institute. Is it Han?
Yeah.
All right. Dr. Han is the principal investigator of the BMSF-funded Maine Lung Cancer Coalition and also leads projects focused on tumor genomic profiling in cancer care and the development of decision support tools and medical education programs to help clinicians, patients, and laypersons effectively communicate, understand, and use risk information in medical decisions. Please help me welcome Dr. Paul Han.
Thank you all, and I just want to apologize for the technical difficulties this afternoon with this presentation, but I think we have things squared away. And I just want to start also, thank you all for that introduction, and both to you and John for, I think, a really kind of awe-inspiring set of presentation this morning. I have to say, I just sat there being bowled over by hearing your testimony and just you sharing your emotions and your journey was really meaningful to me personally. So I just want to thank you for that. And I'd love to actually invite you down to Southern Maine at some point to talk to some audiences, down south. I think it would be really helpful. But I want to thank you for that. And I also want to thank Michael and all of you for giving me the chance to be here today. So this is going to be a little bit of shifting of gears compared to the talks this morning. I believe in retrospect it's going to be kind of boring and dry compared to actually hearing from actual patients and experiences, because in the end I think that's what we're all about. We care about patients and we want to help patients, and we want to have every person have the best care that they can to make it through the cancer journey. And I think that's why the testimonies this morning were just so inspiring and I think very valuable. In comparison, we're going to have to shift perspective here and talk about a program and talk about kind of an initiative that is really geared towards improving health outcomes among our patients in Maine. And we've had the opportunity, and I think the good fortune, to receive some funding to develop a new program for our state that really tries to put patients first and the well-being of all of you and other residents of the state first, and to think about how we can all work together to improve the health of people in Maine. So the Maine Lung Cancer Coalition is what I'm really going to talk about. We call this the MLCC. It used to be called the Lung CAPS Project. We've gone through some transformations in our own acronyms. But essentially, it's a statewide initiative being led by these few people who are listed here. And as I'm going to explain to you a little bit more about, this is really an effort to engage as many institutions and stakeholders from all around the state on this effort. In essence, this is what the initiative amounts to. It's a four-year project that's dedicated to reducing the burden of lung cancer in Maine. And I would say that clearly lung cancer is the focus here, but at least for those of us involved in the initiative, we have bigger aspirations that the partnerships that we form and the evidence that we generate through this initiative can also help patients with other kinds of cancer and provide kind of working relationships and the infrastructure to make a difference for all patients with cancer in Maine. It's multi-institutional, and it's a collaborative partnership. And the central areas of focus are prevention, early detection, but we're also interested in treatment in the sense that we're interested in discovering ways to make sure that we can more efficiently refer patients with newly diagnosed lung cancer into care to receive timely and high-quality multidisciplinary care. And we're also focusing on expanding access. So the big theme in this initiative is to eliminate geographic barriers to access to care. And so we're interested in particularly in understanding the barriers that rural patients face and to overcome those barriers to care. So there's two kind of high-level goals of this initiative. One is to engage and educate. So how can we engage various stakeholders in the state, whether patients and community members, but also healthcare providers, physicians and allied health professionals, policymakers. We're interested in really casting a broad net to engage as wide a variety of stakeholders as we can, and to provide education to really improve awareness of evidence-based approaches to preventing lung cancer, detecting it early, and treating it. And then, secondly, we want to innovate and evaluate. So we want to develop new ways to overcome geographic barriers to access to care, and we also want to evaluate what we do. So there's a strong research component to this, where we want to test the effectiveness of whatever interventions that we develop. This is an initiative that's generously funded by the Bristol-Myers Squibb Foundation, as well as the Maine Cancer Foundation and the Maine Economic Improvement Fund. And here are the partners that we have, the primary partners. Now, this list was created when we first initiated this proposal about now 2 years ago, or 1.5, 2 years ago. But since then, actually, this list has grown. And in fact, one of my reasons here, I'll just lay it out there initially, is that we'd like to partner with all of you as well. And thanks to Michael and I chatting and meeting at a Maine Cancer Foundation meeting a little over a year ago, what we really want to do is make connections like this. And we want to engage more of our partners in other parts of the state. And so the fact is that we'd like you to be on this list as well. That's one of my ulterior motives coming up here. So first I want to lay some of the conceptual foundations and the rationales for why this initiative exists, and to talk about the problems specifically of lung cancer in Maine. So, and some of this information I think is old news for many of you. You've probably seen these statistics before, but I want to just go over them quickly to paint the picture of why this initiative is important. So, lung cancer in general is one of the primary forms of suffering and death, or causes of suffering and death from cancer in the country, but it's also a leading cause of suffering and death in the state of Maine. So it's the third most common cancer, period, if you look at all the kinds of cancers that people develop, but it's the number one cause of cancer death in Maine. So it's clearly an important problem from a public health perspective. Most of the cancers that are diagnosed at a late stage, meaning at an untreatable stage where cancer cannot be cured. It has the sixth highest incidence. That means year to year, when you look at new diagnoses of cancer in general, it's the sixth most common cause, and also that it's the 12th highest cause of mortality in the U.S. It's linked to tobacco use. That we all know that. Most people understand that smoking is the major risk factor for lung cancer. And we also know that particularly Maine is a smoking state. So it's in the top five. It's probably number three. I think these statistics might change a little bit. I haven't seen the most recent ones, but we're definitely a heavily smoking state. And particularly in rural areas. I'm going to show you a little bit of data on that as well. And we also think that in Maine, we have the misfortune of having a radon problem that's inordinate compared to other states in the country. And that probably has to do with the granite and the geography. You all have heard about this problem before. We also know that other environmental risk factors are probably important in our state, including arsenic, which is a known carcinogen, and it increases the risk of lung cancer. And then finally, there are geographic and sociodemographic risk factors, not only for cancer, but for many different conditions, but I think they become especially important in cancer, and that's a major focus of our initiative as well. So here's some geographic data. If you look at the state of Maine, and you can see particularly Washington, so red is bad. So this means that this is looking at the incidence rates of lung cancer, so new diagnoses of lung cancer in Maine. Anywhere you see red, dark blue is kind of good. That's the lowest incidence of lung cancer, but you can see Washington County is a hot spot for this. A little bit less so with Hancock County. It tends to be on the low end. You also have to realize that some of these statistics have a little bit more estimation error just because of the low population density in some of these areas. But it's been pretty well established that, in particular, Washington County is kind of a hot spot in terms of lung cancer incidence. If you look at lung cancer deaths, you can see there's also uneven distribution throughout the state. Here, you know, there's maybe pockets in Washington County that are higher incidence, but there's other counties that are also hot spots that we want to know more about, and we want to do something about in the future. And then if you look at smoking rates on the right-hand side, that's also illuminating because it shows that the primary risk factor for lung cancer is also unevenly distributed. So the point of these slides is not to sort of look at every single county, but it's to show that these risk factors for lung cancer that are behavioral, but also lung cancer incidence and death itself, they're not evenly distributed through the state. And why is that? Those are scientific questions about why that's the case, but it also shows us that we ought to be paying particular attention to these sort of hotspot areas to try to do something. Then if you look at so-called social determinants of health, these are things that we know limit access to healthcare, and they're also associated with limited knowledge about health problems like lung cancer. There's also very uneven distribution as well. So lack of education and also poverty, these are unevenly distributed through the state. If you look at, this is the last geeky graph I'm going to show you, but this is basically showing that over 1,000 people are dying from lung cancer yearly in our state. And for such a small state, that's bad. Okay, and we need to do something about this. We don't make anything about this slight decrease in 2015. I mean, we wonder whether some of that could be attributable to screening, which I'm going to talk about. But really, these trends are not very significant. And I just want to put this up to make the point that there are too many needless deaths, preventable deaths from lung cancer. So what's the solution to this problem of lung cancer and the burden of lung cancer in Maine? We think, and the main justification and rationale for this initiative is that collaboration is one solution to the problem. You know, Maine's a small state in terms of population. I mean, geographically it's large, but our population is small. We have a lot of programs that are scattered throughout the state, a lot of healthcare providers and hospitals. All of us are busy in our own little corners of the world trying to do things on our own. And we believe that actually that's hampering our ability to be more effective as a state in addressing this really critical problem. And so part of the rationale for this initiative is to start working together. Let's try to share knowledge and reach across institutional boundaries that kind of separate us and try to share knowledge and best practices so that we can tackle this problem together. And that really, to me, is the primary impetus for this whole initiative. And so we want to try to leverage existing resources and expertise throughout the state. We want to go across disciplines as well as institutions. And really, we want to result in an end state where we're strengthening our state's capacity to address the lung cancer problem. So I'm going to talk a little bit about what this initiative is, how it's structured, and what we're really doing with it. And again, here are the two kind of goals that we talked about: engage and educate, and innovate and evaluate. And this is a really complicated slide. It's a so-called logic model of the whole initiative. And I'm just going to kind of walk you through this because I do think it if you stare at it long enough, you'll get the idea. So basically, so we're starting at a high level with creating a statewide system, again, devoted to the prevention, screening, and more effective treatment of lung cancer. The idea is that we want to expand access to evidence-based interventions that will achieve that very high-level goal. We're going to engage with multiple different stakeholders, ranging from healthcare providers to patients and policymakers. And then we have these sort of four, four kind of slightly lower level goals of building capacity, expanding access to care, engaging patients and stakeholders, and promoting evidence-based practice. Then beneath these, this is just sort of our administrative structure of this program. And we've really built all of these activities of the project into three so-called cores. We have a prevention core, early detection core, and a stakeholder education and engagement core. This is really more administrative, that we're basically working with people and tasking them to be in charge of these sort of three sets of activities. And I'm going to talk to you about the middle stuff, the actual work that we're doing to accomplish those high-level goals. And then again, the whole idea is to innovate and evaluate. These are at the ends, and educate and engage different stakeholders. So here are this is kind of another slide that blows up into more detail the separate activities. I'm not going to go through every one of these. We can kind of talk about this if you have questions at the end. Or if you have questions at any time, actually feel free to interrupt me and we can kind of address specific things. But again, in the middle, the whole idea is building a coalition, working together. And around those, we have different activities aimed at the two goals of engaging and educating, innovating and evaluating. We have several different pilot projects that I'm going to describe in a little bit more detail that aim to get at these different tasks. And we're working with people around the state who have stepped up to work with us to do smaller demonstration projects to really try to innovate, evaluate, or to engage and educate the public. And I'm going to talk a little bit more about those, about these things in particular. So some of our work, this is the kind of unsung heroes of our initiative, our data analytic team. And they work with us to really try to collect data and to enable us to evaluate the effectiveness of what we do, as well as to create data resources that can be used not only by our initiative, but by anyone in the state. So we're trying to create publicly available databases that will allow people ranging from the government to healthcare institutions to actually understand the burden of lung cancer better. So we're developing new data sets. We're linking different data sources like the All Payer Claims data set, as well as the Behavioral Risk Factor Surveillance Survey, state death records, and also the state cancer registry data. And our dream is to create a combined data set that will allow us to really drill down and understand what's happening with lung cancer over time, and to do both research and quality improvement activities. And this is more work than it seems, just to even link data sets. So this is like a big undertaking that in the end is going to produce a rich data resources for the resource for the whole state. And secondly, on the right-hand side, we're actually starting to analyze this data. So we're using these data to get a better understanding of the distribution of lung cancer and outcomes of lung cancer. And again, the whole idea is to contribute knowledge that we can all share. So this is not knowledge that just a couple people are going to use. This is going to be a data resource that will help us understand not only lung cancer, but other cancers. Because by linking these data sets, it's going to include data on every other cancer as well. So these are the kind of, around these Venn diagrams are the different kinds of data resources that are being linked together, again, to produce this combined data set that's going to allow us to understand the burden of lung cancer better. What we found already in doing some preliminary analyses, some of which those maps that I showed you of the state are the result of our preliminary analyses to sort of look at how lung cancer and risk factors are distributed, and to understand geographic variation. We're already also examining the relationship between lung cancer incidence and mortality and things like smoking rates and poverty, and those analyses are ongoing. And then we're also going to start looking at treatment. We're going to both screening and treatment to sort of understand what's happening around the state with those things. And again, this is all going to be knowledge that we believe will help us to ultimately manage lung cancer better and to reduce suffering and death from lung cancer in our state. And so these are some of the future activities that we have planned in that regard for the data handling team. We also have a bunch of activities that are focused really on improving lung cancer prevention. And these activities are more focused on things like helping people or identifying people with heavy smoking histories, helping them to stop smoking, encouraging education about risk factors like radon, reaching out to the community, developing messages and marketing strategies to reach populations to raise awareness about both lung cancer prevention and screening. So these activities are being led by Natalie Morse at Maine General Prevention Center, and they also include a project that's looking at the use of community health workers to conduct direct outreach to primary care practices and also people living in the community. And they're mostly right now focusing on Kennebec County, but we're going to be expanding this work to try to reach other populations as well. So this is kind of a small pilot of the use of community health workers. We're also working with the Center for Tobacco Independence to increase their capacity to deliver tobacco treatment and smoking cessation counseling to patients throughout the state. And then also what the Prevention Corps is doing is they're doing outreach, and they've conducted actually a set of what they're calling intercept interviews to understand how residents in rural areas actually perceive and think about lung cancer and lung cancer risk. And I'm actually going to share with you a few of their initial findings in a moment. And they're working with a marketing company to actually develop public service announcements and messages that we're going to be releasing more generally to try to get the public to think about lung cancer risk and lung cancer screening. Finally, they're working with some primary care practices that are affiliated with Maine General Hospital to increase the practice's ability to identify patients at risk for lung cancer and to provide screening services for them. So, I'm going to present some of the highlights of these intercept interviews. And these are interviews that the prevention team has conducted just with people on the street that they would meet at like cafes and community centers and so forth, just where they would just briefly ask them, I think these lasted 15 or 20 minutes, just to kind of talk to them and get their input on what they think about lung cancer and lung cancer risk. And the reason is to try to understand how people who are outside of the healthcare system and difficult to reach, how are they thinking about lung cancer? And because we have to understand how people think about cancer before we can actually design outreach strategies for them. One common thing that they found out was that when people think about, well, here I am, I'm a heavy smoker, what can I do about it? People pretty much attribute to their continued smoking to a lack of willpower. And they are thinking about smoking as something that is only treated, for example, by cold turkey. So they haven't been really taught or informed about other approaches to stop smoking. And this was a very prevalent perception that, you know, blaming it on willpower or continued smoking being the result of a lack of willpower and cold turkey being the only way to address that. Some other questions asked respondents, had they heard of a link between radon exposure and lung cancer? And you can see that a majority of respondents were not even aware of that link between radon and lung cancer, which is also concerning. So again, just showing us how much work or how far we have to go with a lot of these outreach efforts. Some other questions, you know, asked respondents, what are the barriers to getting screened for lung cancer, fear of cancer being a barrier to even going and getting screened was identified as a big problem. The concerns about the affordability of screening and lung cancer care also rose to the top. Then we kind of asked people too, like if you were going to, you know, kind of talk about lung cancer prevention and lung cancer screening or get more information? How would you want to receive this information? And here we're interested in learning, are they receptive to one-on-one or group counseling, or would they want to talk to a community health worker? Would they want to talk to a PCP? We're a little concerned about what seems to be a lack of enthusiasm about engaging with professionals. But again, the reason we ask these questions is that we're just trying to understand what the barriers are to really engage these populations. So then the stakeholder education and engagement core, and that's kind of the second set of activities that we've been devoted to. They are doing a few things, actually, to advance that line of work. They're, number one, doing what we're calling here a vulnerable population demonstration project. This is actually a qualitative focus group study that they've been conducting with residents, actually up in Washington County, to try to understand, what are their perceptions of lung cancer screening in particular, and what do they think of this test. And this is being done by our colleagues at USM, and that work is just being completed now. And then there's some activity that is going on with community outreach. USM is also doing these kinds of activities to try to do some planning work to strategize about how we can more effectively reach rural populations. And then finally, we're working with the American Lung Association of the Northeast to conduct what we were calling screening summits, meaning statewide meetings to engage with providers of lung cancer screening services to share best practices. And I'm going to talk a little bit more about that, because that's become actually a more major activity of the whole initiative. And then we are also doing or trying to do some policy work to advocate for lung cancer related issues. And for example, some of you may know that lung cancer screening through MaineCare was being considered last year, and so members of our initiative testified to the legislature about the value of lung cancer screening to advocate for coverage of this through MaineCare. And then we are also trying to make inroads in policy around radon, both screening and radon testing, as well as mitigation. And those things are very difficult tasks to try to influence policy, but we're working with our state government partners and others to try to develop strategies to advocate for these issues. And then we're also working with Maine Quality Counts. Some of you may be familiar with that organization, but they do a lot of training for health professionals and practices, as well as lay communities, around various topics in healthcare quality. So we're working with them, and they're actually developing an online webinar series. We've actually conducted two webinars already for primary care practices to teach them about lung cancer prevention and screening. So finally, what I'm gonna talk about the most, and I know we're running out of time.
Go to 3:15.
Okay.
So
yeah.
I think
well, given our technical difficulties, or I'll try to speed up a little bit. But a major focus of this initiative is early detection and or lung cancer screening, and I'm going to talk a little bit more about what that is and some of the excitement around a new technology, but. A lot of the activities of the initiative really center around improving awareness about lung cancer screening and increasing institutions' ability to deliver lung cancer screening more effectively. And what we would like to see as the end state of all of this work is that all institutions around the state who have the capacity to really do lung cancer screening, we would like them to be doing it. And we would like them to do it in a consistent, evidence-based manner. So what we want to do is share what those best practices are, assess the capacity of all these organizations, and to help people offer lung cancer screening. And I'm going to talk a little bit more about why we want to do that and what lung cancer screening entails. But basically, we're engaging in education activities. We're engaging in activities to try to set standards for lung cancer screening and to educate the provider community about this. And we're doing a couple of pilot projects that are examining things like the use of nurse navigators as sort of coordinating staff for lung cancer screening programs. And we're also doing a pilot project to test the use of telemedicine in providing shared decision-making counseling prior to lung cancer screening in two practices. So we're doing these things to really, again, innovate and develop new ways to expand access to these services to patients in rural communities. And then finally, this idea of a learning community, what was on the other slide called the summit, we have actually formed a network and a coalition of institutions around the state, both large and small, that we're hoping we can eventually include pretty much every hospital who's interested in screening. Even if the hospitals aren't providing the screening, if they're simply interested, we want there to be a really broad representation of organizations in this learning community, which meets quarterly. And so we've now had two meetings. We would love it if hospitals, MDI, and others in the area could join with us. And we're going to have regular quarterly meetings where we address what are the best practices for lung cancer screening, and we share knowledge so we all kind of get on the same page and work through problems and hopefully increase people's capacity to offer lung cancer screening. I'm not going to really get in. This is kind of a schematic of how learning collaboratives operate. Typically people define a problem and come together and then they go through these what's called PDSA cycles. I'm not really going to get into that now. We're really, this learning community is a little bit less formal, but we are going to meet regularly, face-to-face, on a quarterly basis, and I feel like the first two meetings have been a really great success, and people are really energized and working together. We have people, we have institutions who are, in theory, competitors or enemies, whatever you want to look at it, who, it's so gratifying, we're all sitting around the same table and saying, let's just put our patients first, and let's figure out what's the best way to do screening, how do we get people screen, how we do this in a way that's going to put our patients first and improve their health. And that to me is what's most exciting about this initiative. So I won't really get into that as well because of time. We've had a couple of meetings of the learning community. I want to, though, at least introduce to you, I want to talk a little bit about what lung cancer screening is, for your knowledge. And so I'm going to just spend the last few minutes talking about that. Again, I'm going to go through this a little bit more quickly than I wanted to, but just to really highlight a few points. So what this is all about is that prior to this study, which was reported in 2011, there was no good way to screen for lung cancer. You may have seen physicians in the past order chest x-rays or sputum samples way back in the day. None of these have ever been shown to actually be effective in detecting lung cancer early or influencing death from lung cancer. But back in 2011, this landmark study was reported in the New England Journal of Medicine that used low-dose CT scans instead of chest x-rays to try to detect lung cancer early. The point is that these aren't regular CTs. They don't use a full dose of dye and amount of radiation. They use a lower dye dose and a lower amount of radiation. But just enough to do kind of a quick and dirty would be, too negative a way to put it, but it's not a full-blown chest CT scan, but it's enough to detect nodules, little small tumors that are at a treatable stage. And so that's the whole point of this. And this trial, I'm not going to really go through all of these bullets, but basically it was a large, hugely expensive a randomized trial that gives us the highest form of evidence about the effectiveness of a medical intervention. And people got three annual CT scans and then were followed for about 6 to 7 years after that. And then basically what they did is they counted how many people died from lung cancer or for any reason at the end of the trial and compared the number of deaths in the people who received the scans compared to the people who received chest x-rays, which we know are ineffective. So it's essentially received nothing that was effective. It excluded people who were too sick to have surgery or who had limited life expectancy because that would be the treatment. If you get a tumor detected, you're gonna get it taken out. So if you're too sick to even get it taken out, then there's no, you wouldn't be considered for screening anyway. So they excluded those types of people or people with other cancers as well. And what they basically found was that this is kind of, in a nutshell, what this trial found. It showed that there was about, and you'll see this statistic quoted, a 20% reduction in lung cancer deaths. Now you have to realize, though, that that's a relative, what we call relative risk reduction, meaning if you compare the rates, you know, of the two, if you look at the absolute number of people who died, it saved about 3 out of 1,000 lives. Okay, so 3 out of 1,000 people benefited from screening. It's not as impressive when you put it that way than the 20%, but it's still something. It was significant. And if you think about it, if you're one of those three people, that means something, right? And I'm going to show you some other data that compares that. But and then it also reduced, it reduced all deaths from any cause by about 5 out of 1,000. It's not a slam dunk, though. Okay, for other reasons. You know, some people would argue that 3 out of 1,000 is kind of small, and you know, this is why it's really up to the individual to judge the worth of that. But the one thing that it did, that one problem it did cause, was a lot of false positives. So about 25% of patients who went through screening were identified with a nothing. You know, something they said was abnormal, but only on further evaluation it's found not to be cancer. So you have to weigh that. You know, that'll cause worry, and in a rare amount of cases, it led to more biopsies, even surgery in a few cases, all to find out that you don't have cancer. That's the cost, not financial, but that's the cost of screening. And then the other issue is it involved radiation exposure, and we actually don't know what the effects of that is because it hasn't been studied long enough. So it's not a slam dunk, really, that it should be offered to everybody, but we do think it should be offered, and then individual patients should decide whether they want to go through with it or not through a process of shared decision making. For some people who might, and you can see here, this slide just shows a false positive rate, so it's not ignorable. It's a pretty significant false positive rate. Mammography is about 10 to 12%. Lest you think that this 3 out of 1,000 benefit is tiny, it's actually not when you look at other screening tests. So for mammography, for example, you can, if you flip 3 out of 1,000, if you invert that, you'll get what's called the number needed to treat. So basically, that results in a number needed to treat of about 300. That means you have to do 300 scan. You have to scan 300 people to save one life. But if you look at like PSA screening, prostate cancer screening, or mammography has a number needed to treat of about almost 2,000. You know, you have to do 2,000 mammograms to save one life. Right? So it's not, lung cancer screening is not necessarily piddly, you know, but compared to other things that we do. So therefore, U.S. Preventive Services Task Force and many other professional organizations have recommended screening. It's now being covered by CMS as well as other health insurers, and they gave it a grade B recommendation. Grade A is best, but B, they hedged a little bit because of the potential harms and so forth. But I've already told you that it's not a slam dunk because of false positives, and there's also unknowns here. You know, and these are the reasons that give us a little bit of pause. So none of us say that everybody who is at high risk should get screened. We think that it should be offered, and then the individual should make an informed decision after a shared decision-making counseling with the provider. And this is why that's the case. And so I've kind of talked about all these kind of uncertainties about screening that really create the demand for shared decision-making. CMS itself has said that, therefore, if anyone does get screened, that they must have a shared decision-making counseling visit prior to getting screened. So this is actually a federal mandate to happen. Now, whether people really do that and whether it's enforceable, that's a completely different question, but at least CMS says it should happen. And if you're thinking about shared decision-making, that's a process where basically the provider and the patient work together to think about a decision and to make it thoughtfully based on the patient's own values. Easier said than done, because this requires time, it requires people to sit down and have a good discussion, and these are hard things to do. Basically, a provider would need to ensure that all of these things happen, that there needs to be discussion of everything I just told you about, and an exploration of what's important to the patient. This takes time, and quite honestly, most physicians have not been trained in really how to do this in a systematic way. And so we've developed things like, you can't read this, I know, but we've developed decision tools, like counseling tools that a doctor could use with a patient to sit down that goes through all of those informational points. And one key activity of our learning community is to work with all of our providers to sit down and say, hey, how do we refine this? Let's design a tool that we'll all use. Let's use a consistent tool statewide so that our patients are getting the same information and getting high quality information. So that's one goal of our collaborative. And then when you think about it though, the whole problem with lung cancer screening is that I would argue it's the most complicated screening test. I mean, it's not as simple as like ordering a mammogram or a pap smear or a colonoscopy. There's all these steps that any program, any hospital that offers screening needs to ensure that these things happen, that people get the right people get identified, that there's the right CAT scan facility, there's the right dye protocol, there's the right reading protocol, there's the right follow-up for abnormals. And so it's very complicated. And for this reason, you know, we need to work together. We need to make sure that hospitals and providers are all doing this in a consistent manner. And it's not really easy. So, basically, my take-home message is that we need and want you, meaning you, all of you, in Hancock, Washington County, all this whole area, we would love to partner with all of you to sort of help get the word out, but also engage with you as both patients and providers to sort of join us in this effort. And we certainly want to, you know, again, put our patients first and figure out ways that we can partner with one another to promote awareness and best practices for both lung cancer prevention and screening. And what our vision is that this will also spill over into how we can approach other cancers as well as a state, and thinking about, you know, helping patients get the best care possible close to home, trying to have providers work collaboratively and share information, reduce unnecessary variation in how different institutions and providers approach lung cancer prevention, screening, and treatment, and really working together to do that. So thanks for your attention. And I'm sorry I breezed through a lot of this quicker than I wanted to, but I'm happy to answer questions if we have time, you know, for at least a couple of questions. So,
I was 10 minutes.
Okay. Great, thank you.
So, I'm wondering if you ever consider exposure to secondhand smoke as one of the variables. Because those of us that grew up in the 50s, 60s, and even 70s, everywhere you went, restaurants, everything, you were just bombarded with smoke.
Yeah, it's a really good question, and unfortunately there's not good data on that, but we're hoping to capture that kind of data. So if you look at that trial I presented, that's called the National Lung Screening Trial that was published in 2011, they had a pretty strict set of criteria by which they defined high risk, and they used that to determine